वॉर्म गुड मॉर्निंग टू ऑल ऑफ यू. ऑन बिहाफ ऑफ गुजरात रिसर्च सोसाइटीज हंसराज जीवनदास कॉलेज ऑफ एजुकेशन आई एक्सटेंड अ वेरी वॉर्म वेलकम यू ऑल टू दिस कैपेसिटी बिल्डिंग प्रोग्राम फॉर टीचर्स ऑन गेमिफिकेशन इन लर्निंग. In collaboration with Paratus Knowledge Ventures Private Limited, the COVID-19 pandemic continues to cause disruptions to the education industry, and this pandemic has forced educational institutions around the globe to move online in just matter of days. While the people from academia had thought or hoped that this situation is going to be short-lived, but the current developments indicate the opposite. Online teaching is here to stay. With this realization, pressure is mounting on teachers to step up their online teaching expertise and get familiar with the various new teaching strategies to be used effectively through digital mode. With this objective, the IQAC of Gujarat Research Society's Hansraj Jeevandas College of Education organize this capacity building program for teachers on gamification in learning under the aegis of RUSA. To begin with the program, I request Dr. Usha Borkar, the IQAC coordinator, to deliver the welcome speech. Over to you, Dr. Borkar.
Thank you, Dr. Karuna Sinha. Good morning, one and all. It is my proud privilege to have received this opportunity on behalf of our parent body, Gujarat Research Society, our principal madam, Dr. Anita Swami, and the entire HJC team to welcome our resource person, Ms. Sanjot Patkar, Director, Paratus Knowledge Ventures Private Limited, and all the teacher participants to this capacity building program on gamification and learning organized by Internal Quality Assurance Cell of HJCE under the aegis of RUSA in collaboration with Paratus Knowledge Ventures Private Limited. Gujarat Research Society's Hansraj Jeevandas College of Education is a pioneer teacher education institution and one of the very few autonomous colleges of education in India. Since its inception in 1969, HJCE is continuously striving to produce quality and relevant teachers. COVID-19 pandemic and the subsequent global lockdown, which has now gone on for 3 months, has disrupted all aspects of our lives and has thrown new challenges. The COVID-19 pandemic has sparked a global realization that our current way of life does not work. The clear disruption in the normal functioning of education has placed an emphasis on online education or e-learning, which has now become the new normal. Though teaching moved online, but it has happened on an untested and unprecedented scale. This has resulted in many educators merely shifting the age-old teaching ways from face-to-face situation to an online environment. And the result of this has been the Zoom bombing experienced by our students. Though this Zoom bombing was a lifesaver in the beginning of the lockdown, but today, we all teachers grapple only with one major question. How do I, as a teacher or a facilitator, increase student participation, engagement, and interaction in my online class? So now, we find a scenario wherein, after initial experimentation of conducting online classes using varied video conferencing apps, teachers are now embarking on a quest of reinventing themselves to cope up with changing needs, preferences, and requirements of our digital native students. With these considerations, team at JC, under the dynamic leadership and guidance of our principal madam, Dr. Anita Swami, and our parent body, Gujarat Research Society, has organized a series of sessions under capacity building program for teachers, students, and admin staff. Gamification in learning is our seventh such program in this direction. The gamification of learning is an educational approach to motivate students to learn by using video games design and game elements in learning environment. The goal is to maximize enjoyable and engagement through capturing the interest of learners and inspiring them to continue learning and moreover, create a joyful and meaningful online learning environment. Peter Drucker, the famous management guru, once commented, "If you want to progress, you must have two kinds of mentors. One, much elder to you so as to gain from their experience. And the other, much younger to you so you learn from their fresh, flexible ideas and the courage to undertake risk." We found this very fresh perspective towards technology-driven learning in the young and dynamic team of Partis Knowledge Ventures Private Limited, and hence felt that it would be a wonderful opportunity to collaborate and figure out how to drive learner engagement at a higher scale. I once again welcome all of you and hope that you will definitely find the session extremely informative, enjoyable, and above all, valuable in your own journey of designing a more interactive online learning environment. Thank you for joining us today, and we truly appreciate your zeal and enthusiasm to being a lifelong learner. With this, I request my colleague, Dr. Karuna Sinha, to take the day's session ahead. Over to you, Dr. Karuna Sinha.
Thank you, Dr. Borkar. Thank you so much for highlighting the importance of gamification in teaching, especially through the digital mode. I'm sure that we are going to explore more in today's session as far as gamification is concerned. Now, taking the session ahead, I request my colleague, Dr. Pallavi Talekar, to introduce the resource person for today's session, Ms. Sanjot Patkar, to you all. Over to you, Dr. Talekar.
Thank you, Karuna ma'am. Good morning, all. I have proud privilege to introduce our guest for capacity building program for teachers, Ms. Sanjot Patkar. Ms. Sanjot Patkar is director of Partis Knowledge Ventures Private Limited. She holds electronics and telecommunication engineering degree from Pune University and MBA from Symbiosis Institute of Telecom Management. She served in analytics and business reporting roles across industries, IT and ITES. Over 14 years, she has run Fundamentals specializing in gamified learning and data analysis. She has extensively worked in this domain in the companies such as Cognizant and Tata Consultancy Services. Partis Knowledge Ventures Private Limited delivers a unified digital experience to the customers through the bandwidth of services and products like consulting, marketing, content, training, and assessment and data analytics services. One of the flagship programs of Partis Knowledge Ventures Private Limited is Fundamentals. Fundamentals specializes in gamified LMS and assessment. It believes in developing children for future. The innovative game-based solutions have been designed keeping in mind the traits such as critical thinking, data inference, communication, problem solving, and decision that are needed to deal with changing landscape of professional choices. Fundamental has been started by IIM alumni and it is highly awarded gamified platform. Some of the achievements of Fundamental are winners of UK Government Tech Rocket Ship Award to Indo-UK Tech Summit, selected for Google Launchpad Build, winner of Impact Award in Facebook's India Innovation Challenge, IBM Startup Finalist, winner of MIT School of Telecom Startup Award for Innovation, Fundamental Features in Key Vendors in Global Education Gamification Market reports by Technovia, a leading UK-based market research organization, and it's leading this report for the past 4 consecutive years. On behalf of Gujarat Research Society, Hansraj Jeevandas College of Education, Management, Principal, and Staff, I extend a warm welcome to Ms. Sanjot. Ms. Sanjot, everyone is eagerly waiting to learn new skills from you. I request you to kindly begin the session. Thank you.
Thanks. Thank you. And thanks everybody, the school, college management, for such a lovely welcome. And you know, good morning to everybody. And it's wonderful that everybody could make it on a Saturday morning. Everybody's you know, home chores, and I know it is a difficult time for everybody, and especially with personal commitments also on Saturdays. So I will you know, try to keep the session interactive and keep the session visually engaging as much as possible. So I will do one thing. I will hide my camera, and I would like Dr. Pallavi to kind of allow me to share the screen.
Sanjot, I have allowed you to share the screen.
Okay, great. So once again, welcome. We will try and do the session on gamification on in learning and development. Though we will kind of have a couple of case studies, see how we can kind of apply these techniques for online as well as offline, you know, education. No matter how much we discuss, you know, we can spend hours in discussing what gamification is, how we can apply this in our classroom sessions, as well as try to do an online engagement with students. We will just land up scratching the surface. So it is a huge topic for, and an area of discussion. So let's, you know, I'll try and see how much I can capture today. So the agenda for today is, she has already given you an introduction. I'll just give you a brief of what we do. What is gamification and what is not gamification, to kind of dispel the myths around it. I will take you through a very famous case study of Nike Plus, which will kind of correlate with what is gamification, give you an example of gamification through some games that we will play. What
Ms. Sanjot, sorry to disturb you. We are not able to see your screen.
Okay, sorry. I'll just check a second. Are you able to see my screen now?
Yes.
Okay, sorry. And what are the uses of gamification? Online gamification, as well as how you can do an offline gamification whenever you resume your classes. So just, you know, encapsulating again in terms of who we are, she has already given a wonderful introduction. We started, you know, our product is fundamental. We are a company called Asparatus Knowledge Ventures. We engage into gamification as well as data analytics, which you rightfully pointed out. Gamification, we primarily started off with applying gamification in education field for schools and colleges. And over a period of time, with the kind of experience and the user response we got and the requests that started coming in, we kind of branched out to even corporates. So we kind of started applying these gamification techniques for recruitment assessment, onboarding in kind of corporates. Today, we are kind of present across 100 schools, and we have more than 20,000 plus students from schools as well as colleges. We have schools which have enrolled in from Singapore, China, USA, and India. Fortunately, this kind of took good shape, and we saw good user response. So this is a just quick introduction of about us. So moving ahead, what is gamification? I'm sure some of you would have researched on this before joining this session, but traditionally gamification, this is a textbook definition of gamification. Gamification is the concept of using game design elements and game design techniques in non-game applications to make them more fun and engaging. Now, what does this really mean? Now, gamification makes use of not just games, but it is thoughtfully designed, systematically and artistically created to make the users more engaging. And in the non-game context, now, what does really a non-game context mean? So means you are playing, okay? You are actually playing a particular game, trying to serve some kind of an objective which or some kind of a purpose which is outside of a game. For instance, you're kind of made to play unknowingly for some social context. You may be playing to get a job, or you may be playing for some business objective, or you may be playing for an educational relation. But you wouldn't really know that you're actually playing for some non-game context, which is outside of the boundary of a particular game. Now, moving on in terms of gamification techniques and strategies. Now, I have picked up some common techniques which are normally used, like leadership boards, social nudging, you know, point system, badging, periodic missions. Now, these are some of the techniques. It is not limited to these techniques, okay? These are commonly used techniques. You can have other techniques also. So there is nothing like right or wrong. And these are the, you know, this is the exhaustive list. You may get more innovative. You can have more type of techniques, whatever is kind of engaging to the end user. But these are the most common kind of techniques. So what does it really entail? Now, gamification makes use of game mechanics, which are constructs of rules. Okay, designed to kind of make an enjoyable journey of the gameplay. So it is typically you have these point system badges. Now let's take the example of periodic missions. Now periodic missions also are called as certain quests or challenges. Now they are a set of tasks given to a user. Now he usually earns a reward in the form of the same time. Once he completes a particular mission, it moves on to the next mission. So this is kind of a periodic mission. Some of you probably would be able to associate this with, you know, a certain video game or a mobile app that you may normally play. So every challenge gets unlocked when you play one particular game, you know, level, then you move on to the next level. So that is kind of a periodic mission. Next is a leaderboard, which is pretty simple. It's a ranking system to show where you stand vis-a-vis the rest of the players. It develops a kind of a competitive spirit within the users to help them move up to see where they stand. You can have it as a daily, you know, scoring system. You can have it as a monthly, and you can have an overall view of the top 5 or the top 10. Then you have badges. Badges is a type of a recognition for a user to display normally it's called as a bragging rights on completion or achievement of a particular task. So it's a very common thing that you would see in a LinkedIn kind of a thing where somebody completes, or even Coursera, you know, if you complete a particular training, you get a badge which you can display on your LinkedIn profile, which is nothing but a sense of achievement. A person has completed something and you can normally display for everybody to know that you have, you know, kind of completed a course, which gives a sense of fulfillment or satisfaction for the user. You have point system, very similar to your scoring system. It helps you to just keep kind of scores. So normally points and leadership boards go hand in hand. Sometimes, you know, leadership boards, it depends on how and where you kind of apply this kind of a technique. It can at times even backfire because some users would not like their own points or scores to be shown, and it can be demotivating to see where you stand. So it depends on really what scenario you would like to apply. Then you have something like a social nudging. Now, social nudging is nothing but, you know, poking others to get them to do a task. Now, you can kind of relate this to something which you have on Facebook, where you have, you know, a message or a video posted by a friend, very good example was yesterday was International Yoga Day, right? So where you have people posting videos. I am doing a particular exercise and yoga, you know, kind of poking you to do this. And unknowingly, people, you know, are encouraged to do this. And the end result is you'll end up exercising. So this is a non-game context. Okay. So I'm sure relate this to normal social media apps. This is very similar to that. This was a little more theoretical. So I will kind of take you through this Nike Plus case study. It's a very popular case study. Now, Nike, I'm sure everybody has heard, it makes running shoes. And they make, obviously want people to run so they can sell more shoes. So they came up with this case study app called as Nike Plus. Now, what Nike Plus does, it makes use of an accelerometer that fits into the sole of your shoe. And this accelerometer tracks how fast you run, how much kilometers that you run, and it communicates with your smartphone or a PC. So it aggregates this data and shows you. So, and they built a set. Now what Nike did was they built a set of applications around this called as you can track how far you have run, how fast you have run. You can check your statistics, this year's statistics versus last year's statistics. You can set a goal, which will encourage you to run. You can set up targets and challenges. It also went one step ahead, tying up with social media, apps where you can share this with your friends and colleagues, inviting them to compete with you. And there are a whole lot of apps around this. You know, if you go to Nike Plus website, you'll be intrigued by the kind of things that they have done. And eventually what happened was they got a lot of people to get running, you know, who are not actually running, by motivating them with this Nike Plus thing. And, this is what happened. They actually built an app where you were running in the real sense and not playing a video game sitting at home. So they got you to exercise and you will end up obviously eventually buying Nike shoes for that. So this is what you mean by non-game context. You're not sitting in front of a video game and actually playing a game which makes you run on a video or a, you know, computer. So it actually develops game like feeling, but in the real context. So I'm sure I'm kind of made sense in terms of what really of non-game context, applying game techniques and game design elements. So I have a few set of games for you. So I would want people to actually take this example, sit back and think what this example really is, you know, and you can type in the chat window and let me know what is this, or kind of raise your hand and I'd like to see, you know, after I spoke, in terms of what gamification is. You've seen a whole lot of examples on LinkedIn and Facebook in terms of, you know, nudging, and you have badges. So, you know, this is an example of LinkedIn. So is this really an example of gamification, or this is just a game where LinkedIn encourages members to fill their profile and all become an, all-star? So I'll just give you a minute to actually reflect on this example, and I would like to see some answers. So this is not just a monologue for me, it's more thought provoking for you. It probably, helps you to correlate with your day-to-day life. Dr. Pallavi, how do I see the chat window? Sorry.
Click on chat button there. Under the screen, you'll find chat button. Click there. You'll be able to see the screen.
Your chat?
Chat.
Okay.
Could you open it?
Yeah, I could see. Okay, so I think I've got a couple of answers. Yes, it is gamification. It is an example of gamification. So yes, everybody's awake. So yes, so this is an example of gamification, and this is an example of social nudging, like I pointed out earlier, where you kind of are nudged by LinkedIn to kind of display your socials, you know, to display your accomplishments, you know, to your peers and colleagues. This is also a form of a bragging, unknowingly you're bragging about your accomplishments. So this is a form of gamification where you're in a non-game context. Okay. And the next example is, I'm sure everybody would have played this game at some point in time. It's a game of Mario, okay, on the mobile. So I would want again everybody to take a moment, whether this is really an example of gamification or not, and you can just type it again in the chat window. I would want to know whether you're clear on the concepts of what is a game and what is a gamification. Okay, actually most of you know, the users have replied it is gamification, but it is not gamification. The reason being, games are not gamification. Gamification is applying game design and game elements and techniques in non-game context. Now Mario game is just a game, you know, where you play for pure joy of it. You are not applying it in a non-game context for a social cause or for a purpose or for some context, be it an education or social purpose or some business objective. So it is just a game which is defined by its own boundaries for the sheer joy of play. So I hope this kind of dispels the myth that all games is not gamification and gamification is not just games. If anybody has questions, please do type in the chat window. We can just take it up at the end of the session. Okay. Another example. There is an email sent to you to unlock the treasure. It's basically a user satisfaction survey. So is this a gamification example? Just type it in the chat window. So okay, so this is again not gamification. I think only Avni Jogi answered this rightly in terms of, you know, it is just a plain survey. Yeah, so by using fancy words like a treasure hunt does not mean gamification. It actually does not make use of any of the gaming elements nor the gaming techniques. You know, it is just a plain survey. So if you get an email, you know, this is, you'll unlock a treasure or you'll get some kind of a reward. It is not gamification. So just don't fall for it that this is a gamification. I think one user rightly pointed out that it is a plain survey. I will move ahead in terms of what are the benefits of gamification and why really gamification? Now, obviously, it is highly powerful and engaging. For it to be highly powerful and engaging, gamified content needs to be very well designed. It has to be very, very attractive to keep the users, you know, engaged for a long time. And if rightfully designed and rightfully created, learning can get very addictive for the users, which is a very big challenge today. It obviously motivates a user, and it can motivate even team players to achieve a certain goal. Real life scenarios can be created on a gamified platform to give users a first-hand feeling of the problem or situation. It's obviously fun and interactive. And such platforms can get users to cooperate and collaborate to get together to do a certain group activity or a group goal, which is a challenge. So if you have, obviously in schools, you have individual activities and group activities. So you can have activities applying gamification techniques for teams to work together. You have for individual students who would want, where you have, you know, you have collaborative work as well as you can have individual related work. So what I'm going to do is I'm taking you through an online implementation. We had a lot of discussion around what gamification is. I will show you one video which we have through our product, which is very easy for you to relate, since most of you are from the teaching background. Basically, it's an online implementation of the school concepts.
Log into Fundamenter.com with your user ID and password.
You will see a welcome video is not visible.
You win one.
Pardon?
A video is not visible. We could see just PowerPoint presentation.
You could just see the PowerPoint.
PowerPoint presentation.
Okay. Can you see the screen now? Can you see the video?
No. I could see this PowerPoint presentation here. Video was on. We could hear it, but we were not able to see the video.
Okay, one second.
Yes, it's visible. Yes.
Program. Log into Fundamenter.com with your user ID and password.
So this is just a sample in terms of how it can be applied for online education.
Your Fundamenter journey starts with a four-part QVIC mission, which tests your quantitative, verbal, inference, and creative thinking aptitude. No preparation is required for the QVIC. Each section is 8 minutes. 7 questions long. The questions are from a variety of topics. The questions may get tougher as you progress. It is a sign that you are doing well. There is an optional break after every section. QVIC mission is just the beginning. The same test is available after completion of the first 7 zones. As you practice more on Fundamenter, you will experience a dramatic increase in your QVIC score. You can explore daily missions from the home screen. Your aim is to complete the daily missions and earn points and badges. The topic and zone for the day are highlighted. There are 7 zones, with each zone having 8 houses. Do daily missions in different topics. Each daily mission has a quiz with 7 questions. Each question is timed. Use hints. Using hints stops the timer. Points are awarded for accuracy and time. Thank you. At the end of the quiz, you get correct answers and a solution to each question. The result screen shows in the quiz and recommends videos for watching. For top two quiz scores in each topic. Watch bite-sized concept videos. After watching videos, attempt the quiz two more times. Each topic can be attempted a maximum of 3 times a day. A topic repeats after every 4 login days. Previously open topics are available in history. Use my space section to track performance, play mini games, and redeem points. The My Performance page is a snapshot of your performance and recommends topics and videos. Mini games are unlocked for some topics. Use the My Games section to practice the concepts that you have learned. You can invite your friends and track their achievements in the My Friends section. Win badges for watching videos and finishing quizzes. You also get badges for expertise in various topics. My Profile section helps you manage your profile, change passwords, change avatar, etc. The notification area informs you when you win a badge, have a friend request, or when your friend request gets accepted. Tag us form to get in touch. If you have any questions, please don't hesitate to write to us at hi@fundamenter.com.
Logo right here. When it-
okay. This screen is visible right now. Hello.
Yes. Your PowerPoint presentation is visible.
Yes. Okay. So the idea of showing this video was to show you how gamification has been applied in the education field. The example that we just saw had elements of all the game design and techniques. You had leaderboards. You had a badge system. You had a point system, you had the ability to share with your friends. You also had the ability to win something, which all are motivating and encouraging. So if you look at, go back to our first slide where it shows gamification is using game design and game elements in a non-game context. What really means is non-game context is you're not actually playing a game. You know, you're playing for a non-game context, which is your education purpose. You're building the aptitude or the ability of a child progressively and unknowingly for a child, which is done very stealthily. If you make him sit and give a test, a child gets conscious. Some children don't open up, and they don't, with the fear of a test or an exam, really don't want to, prepare for it. So here what is happening is, again, obviously see how his friends are doing, and it's more of motivating and encouraging. Obviously, it is visually appealing because, playing a video game or for that matter, something like a spaceship, which all children will, kind of relate to. So every challenge I play, it moves ahead. So you have 3 levels. Progressively, a child unlocks each level, and each level you have certain zones and quizzes. A vision is given to him based on his capability. So every child has his own level of improving progressively. So that exactly what it is being done over here. It's a progressive way and he takes his own time. All the game elements have been applied and it is set in a non-game context. So now I will give you an example for you to get the feel of how a game design and element can be applied in a non-game context. So the next link, I would really appreciate if you can just copy paste and put it on your Internet Explorer. Play this game and see how you can actually do it. It's called as Let Newton Sleep. It's a very simple game. It's not like a typical video game. It's appealing enough for a child to kind of relate and get his concept clear. So I would encourage you to take 2 minutes, type this URL in your Internet Explorer or Google Chrome and see what is the kind of experience that you get, in terms of applying gamification technique for simple mathematics. So if you could just type on the chat window when you're done. When you type the answers, please don't forget to press OK. If you type something incorrectly on the keypad, just press cancel. Okay, I'll just copy paste the link here. 1 second. Where is the chat? Okay, I have pasted it in the chat window for everybody. I hope is easy for you to kind of copy paste it. Okay, I think I will also, I'll just stopping this, Pallavi, I'll open that app so you can get an idea whether that's the correct one.
Okay.
Dr. Pallavi, I hope my screen is visible for the game.
Yes, the screen is visible.
So the idea is the apple is supposed to fall from the tree. It's not supposed to hit Newton's head. He should be sleeping. So if the apple hits Newton's head, he wakes up. We are supposed to type the right answer for the apple not to hit his head. That's why it's called Let Newton Sleep. So if you can type in the chat window, once you have finished playing it, it'll help. This screen is visible, right, Dr. Pallavi?
Yes, your screen is visible.
Okay. So by now you may have got a rough idea in terms of what application of gamification really entails in online education. So I would like now to discuss applying this in offline ways when you actually get back to school and you have students over there. So how is it that we can really, kind of apply these techniques? It's as creative and innovative you can get. You can have a chart paper actually put up in your class, and you can have a leaderboard, or you can have badges given, not just for, somebody having right answers, which normally happens in a class test, but you can have something, displayed in your class for somebody completing his homework on time, really punctual in school activities. It can be something like tidiness of the school student. It's very motivating for the children. You can have something, like a group activity that you may have in your class. So you have one team versus the other team, and you can have a chart paper put up, in terms of how each group submits his activities, a collaborative way of working. So that fosters even team spirit within the class. So it's not just, who finishes first, but it is how the how each team has fared. You could have what are the resources, each team has made use of. You can have something like every time a child raises his or her hand to answer in the class, so that will also promote public speaking and do away with shyness, in terms of answering, be it wrong or right answer. So these are elements which are used in a non-game context. You can have badges, you can have leaderboards, you can have, a few points which are set up, in the classroom. So it's as innovative you can get. So, this is one of the ways, some of the ways which you can actually apply gamification techniques to motivate children in classroom. So with this, I think I will open up the session for Q&A, because I think I have covered most of the aspects in terms of what gamification really means and techniques. Though we just scratched the surface today, it's a big and huge topic for discussion. At least it should get you the concepts and techniques which you can do for online and offline education to motivate children, because it is very difficult to kind of engage children through online education, because children don't sit that long unless it is very engaging for them, and it should be a little stressful, less stressful on the eyes of a child. So, if there are questions, you could just put it in the chat window. Dr. Pallavi, how do you want to take up the questions? Would you be raising the questions, or I have to go through it in the chat window?
No, Ms. Sanjot, I have my colleagues who will be posing questions to me. Okay. Karuna ma'am, will you take over?
Yes, Pallavi. Yes.
Thank you,
Sanjot ma'am. For letting us know today various aspects of gamification technique, case studies, you had beautiful videos. I'm sure all the information which you have given to the teachers, they are definitely going to use that information effectively in their classrooms and make their teaching very effective and engage their students also very effectively in the classroom and make their teaching process fun-filled. Sanjot ma'am, thank you so much for a beautiful presentation. Now we have to proceed ahead with the question answer session. May I request my colleague Dr. Vaishali Savan to take over for the question answer session?
Yes, Karuna ma'am, I'm there. Karna ma'am, I have some issues. I cannot put on my video, but I am sure I'm audible.
Yes, you are audible. You are audible.
Okay, fine.
Yes, okay. You are audible. Okay. Please go ahead.
Yes. Sanjot ma'am, madam, I think I was highly engrossed, you know, in looking at all those games and enjoying those games. And that Newton game was really very interesting. And I'm sure you must be having a lot of interesting, engaging games like this. Of course, I also have many questions for you. But before that, let us take up the questions asked by the participants. There was a request by Prajakta madam to once again explain the difference between game and gamification. Sanjot madam.
Okay. So this is slightly tricky actually. What is gamification and game? I'm sure everybody knows what's a game. Okay. What is a game? See, let's take for instance, what's a ping pong? Everybody knows table tennis, right? What is table tennis? You have two players, two bats or rackets, whatever you call it, and a ping pong ball, right? So you have a certain set of rules defined by ping pong, okay? The players know the rules, audience knows the rules. So you have a game, the players or you play defined by the rules, okay? You play for the sense of enjoyment. Users or players play for the sense of achievement, a certain sense of accomplishment. Can you apply the rules of ping pong in a non-game context? I'll flip the question. The rules of ping pong are applicable only within the boundary of ping pong, right? Or for instance, can you apply the rules of basketball in a non-game context? Okay. So no, you can't really, right? The rules can be understood only by the players or by the audience for ping pong, right? What is the objective of ping pong? Or rather, what is the objective of the players playing ping pong? They need to hit the ball across to the opponent and the ball should not hit the table more than once, right? Or rather, what is the fastest way of getting the ball to the end user, to the opponent? I need to hit the ball on the table only once. Can for any other user, if I look at it, I can take the ball off of the person sitting in the audience. If I have to get the ball fastest to the end user, I can just take the ball and hit it across to him. Why do I need to hit it on the table or hit it only once, right? On the table and not more than once. I can just take the ball and throw it across to him, right? That would be actually the fastest way. So when you define rules or what is a game, it is rules which is defined within a boundary of a game and only players, you can't really apply those rules, you know, outside a game. Now what, now the difference between a game and a gamification or gamifying a certain objective means you take the design elements or the, techniques which are applied in the game. So what is applied in the game is you have to make it engaging, sense of achievement, fulfillment needs to be there. It should be fun. Okay. And apply it in a non-game context. Now you have a scoring system in a ping pong, right? So you're using a scoring system. You're making it engaging for the end users. You want it to be fun. Okay. And take all these elements and apply it in a non-game context. Now, non-game context can be, for instance, education. It can be, for instance, a social cause. Okay. For instance, Nike. Okay. What Nike did, which is a very good example. Okay. They wanted people to buy their shoes. They wanted to improve their sales, right? This is a non-game context. So how do I go and improve my sales, right? I want my sales to improve by people improve buying my shoes. How do I get people to buy their more shoes? By making them run. So how do I make people run? Apply some gamification techniques. How do I apply some of the gamification techniques? I can have a, you know, invite friends to see how I'm doing. Get them to get, obviously that helps, self-motivation is there. I have my point system over there. You can collect badges and go and buy some goodies and freebies from kind of Nike. So this is a non-game context. The user doesn't really understand he's playing a game, but applying in a non-game context, all the game-based techniques are used over here, okay? And it is applied in a real-life scenario. I hope I was able to make sense in terms of gamification. For instance, again, in your education, and let's take offline so you'll be able to relate. I'll use a leaderboard. I can use badges, a simple chart paper, you know, kind of put in a classroom. or any form of a creative thing, you know, that is put a clap, you know, a clapping system put in. So whenever a student, you know, I have a certain student who is faring, who is very, you know, very pro in answering, you know, wrong or right, is very confident. And I want to have a pat on his back, you know, for every time he answers in the class, so that others are motivated to equally participate in the class. So what do? So every time I keep a, you know, badge system in the class or give him a pat. So every time a student answers, I have the entire class clapping for him. So that is what am I doing? I'm using a gamification technique in the my classroom, you know, in a non-game context. This is not a game, you know, where a child is being encouraged to answer. I'm using a real life scenario, and that is what is the end objective. I'm encouraging my students to participate in the class, get out of that fear zone of, you know, of, and encourage them in public. So this is your objective, right? Get more students to answer in your class, or get them to do public speaking in your class, you know. So that is your object. This is your non-game context. And I have used a simple technique of clapping in the class, or I have kept a badge system, so more students are motivated to do that. So I hope I have been able to kind of answer this question in terms of what is a game and what is gamification.
Thank you, Sanjot ma'am. Okay, thank you, Sanjot ma'am. The next question is by Barkha Bale madam, who says that her question is, can we make our own quiz, okay, related to our syllabus and type it in our own, in fundamental?
No, actually the product doesn't really allow you to type, because these are predefined questions which we have created. We have done an extensive study, before actually coming up with the product. We spent 2 to 3 years actually, talking to a lot of users, basically school students, their parents, school faculty, and then came up with this product. So you can't really use that platform and put your own school quizzes. But what you can do in terms of engaging your users, I don't really know how your school would really permit, whichever school you're attached to, have it. And if they permit you to develop an app, or you have a lot of free tools available right now in the market, which can be used to, and you can kind of leverage that and put your question. But don't. They have a very short span of attention. So how is it that you keep them engaged? It's very important, so that they are engaged for the right amount of time and are motivated enough that their learning gets addictive. And we can't really put your questions on fundamental, because this is a predefined product, and we already have a set of questions which are developed.
Okay. I think these are a few common questions asked by Pushti madam and Sakina madam. But can you share some sites where we can prepare our own games, you know, the way we want, using our own method, the subject matter that we want? So can you give us names of such sites?
Am I audible?
Hello? Now you are audible. Now you are
audible. Yes, now you are audible.
Was I audible in the previous question? Sorry, when I answered.
You were audible in the previous question, but for this particular question, initially you were not audible, madam. So if you can repeat what you said.
Okay, sorry. So there are two parts to this. One is building the content, that is your set of questions that you would want, or the set of subjects that you are targeting. You need to have it level wise, okay, in terms of, even if you say, if you're planning to target grade 3 or grade 4, for instance, in grade 3, obviously you would know all students are not at par. Okay, so it's not just grade wise, but in every grade, you need to keep in mind the level of students. All students are not at the same level. So you need to have grade wise as well as level wise content. Second is developing a app or a product of this nature, you have to also have a UI UX in mind. So you have two parts. So when you prepare this, have this in mind. One is a content level and the grade that you're targeting, as well as a UI UX. So I will definitely mail Dr. Pallavi certain sites where you could go and have your questions ported onto that and have a UI UX defined as per that. So I'll note this down and have it mailed to her.
Madam, one more. There is a common question asked by Swati Patil, Madam, Ankush Rathod, sir. How can we have gamification for standard 9, 10, 11th or 12th, where the concepts are more complicated? Like whatever games you showed us were more at the lower, for the lower classes. But what about the higher classes for teaching complex concepts? What about
yes.
that, madam?
I'll give you the example. So we have fundamentals. We've shown you for lower grade. This, the same techniques are applied for till the class 12. This was just a demo, so we've shown you, because it's easy to relate. Teachers are coming from different backgrounds. So I was not sure, which grade. So it starts from the lowest grade of grade 1 or grade 2 and goes on till grade 12. So as the grade increases, the content which is available for each of these grades, is different. So it is when you log into Beat Fundamental or any other app, right? It is on the grade of the child. That's what, when I explain, I think it is kind of correlates to the previous question. When the content is prepared, when you sign up your child for some kind of an online gamification educational app, you sign up with the credentials of which grade the child belongs to. So the content which is thrown to the child is of that particular grade. So the child belongs to a 9th grade or a 10th grade. He will get a content that is visible to him for a 9th grade. The content that is available is immaterial of whether he comes from an SSC background or an ICSE or a CBSE or whichever board. Because finally, when you pass out your 10th or 12th, you're in the open market, right? Nobody really says, okay, I'm from a state board or from an ICSE or a CBSE board. So it targets at your fundamentals at the end of the day. So you may have a Pythagoras theorem, you have algebra, geometry, or a grade 9 or a grade 10, right? So it targets those fundamental questions for a grade 9, 10 or 11, 12 student. So, and in each grade that your child or the student signs up for, right, you have levels. So you have a 9th standard student who comes in, and he's expected, obviously when he has passed from 9th, he would obviously a certain maths fundamental should be clear to him and when he moves. So a student may be very good, but as progressively you see the person who may have fared very well in 8th suddenly goes downwards in the 9th standard. For reasons, it may be n number of reasons, okay? So his fundamentals becomes weaker and weaker. So you would expect him to be a certain level of level 2 or level 3, but he's struggling with level 1. So when he sees his scores in level 1, right, more questions get thrown to him for level 1. Level 1 gets improved. And then it's not that, okay, and when you sign up for something like this, you have to keep in mind, I as a student, when I come to, for instance, I am in level 1, okay, for a grade 9 or a grade 10, I have answered everything, okay, I have fared very well and I moved to level 2. But my friend who has come from 9th grade and is doing a level 1 quiz, his scores are probably below par. You can't say really par. The system will show you, okay, he needs improvement in these areas, okay, in areas, certain topics of geometry. So he will continue to remain in level 1. He will get quizzes of level 1 for that topic continuously till his concepts, concepts starts faring well, he starts improving. So he will not move to level two. Even if he finishes level one or he assumes that he has finished level one, he will continue under level one for those topics again and again and again. Those questions start appearing for him till he starts showing improvement. And once he shows improvement, he will move to the next level only. I hope, you know, this makes sense to him. And obviously, you have the topics get more intense as the levels increase, as well as the grades increase as you move from 9th grade to 10th to 11th and to 12th. I hope I was able to answer his question.
There is one more question. Rather, there are many questions.
Sure, sure.
One question is by Mr. Ganesh. And his question is, when we play an online carom game and we invite friends or make groups, so, you know, can that kind of a game or, you know, because he just mentioned it, so can you call it a game or gamification? And can we use such elements of a game for our, you know, in a, for our teaching learning purpose?
Okay, game of carom is a game, is a pure game. Okay, if you want to use elements of carom in educational for educational purpose, of course you can use elements and techniques of carom, be it carom or for that matter any game, into an educational thing. But the way you apply those techniques and design has to be done by you in terms of how you would want to apply it for and for what purpose, whether you really want for, you know, fundamentals, or it's purely for academia purpose, or is it for sports that you're looking at, or for extracurricular activities of students. So you can definitely apply those. It can be carom, it can be any other game that you have in mind. But you need to understand what techniques from carom that you would want to take, right? Whether you want a teamwork that you're looking at, whether you want individual work that needs to come out from the student. So you can take carom and apply those techniques depending on the area that you're looking at. But obviously you need to, for all these techniques that you apply in whatever scenario, be it academia or sports or non-classroom activities, you have to keep in mind that it has to be engaging for the student, because students get this, you know, one more thing that you need to apply, that some of the gamification techniques can also backfire. So you have to keep in mind, there can be withdrawal symptoms of a child that can come out of it because he may not really like to show where he stands vis-a-vis. You need to be very careful in terms of how you apply those techniques. Some children may not really like their points and scores to be shown in the classroom. So children who fare well may suddenly see not themselves faring well at them. You know, so you can have badges instead of points. So it depends on how you apply. So you may not want points. You can have a clap in the class. You can have a pat on the back. So you need to actually see the mood, the temperament of the students in your classroom, and then apply those techniques. I hope I kind of was able to answer your question.
Thank you, madam. I now request my colleague, Dr. Manjeet Sambe, to take over the remaining questions. Madam?
Yeah. Thank you. Yeah.
Yes, you are.
Good afternoon, Ms. Sanjod Patkar, and thank you very much for such an engaging and an interesting talk that you delivered today in our webinar. The remaining questions that I would like to take up posed by our participants. Madam, are you there? Ms. Sanjod Patkar?
Yes.
Again, there are some common questions which have been put up by the participants. Vidya, Satish, Mukhtar Shah, Shilpa Gupta, they all want to know how they can design a module or such games for their students.
Okay, so what is, this question seems a little generic. Want to design a module, or what is the purpose of the module? Is it some kind of a subject that they're looking at? Is it purely academia? Is it for some, singing activity? Is it for a dance activity? I am not, it's a very, very an open-ended question in terms of how do we go about designing. See, when for any purpose that they are looking at in terms of applying gamification in their school, there are three things that any person or a teacher needs to how do you keep a child or a student engaged for and make the child addictive? It should be engaged, that the child should not, it should be interactive for a child in terms of, and obviously the objective has to be met at the end of the day. You can use any of the techniques that is there. There are a whole lot of techniques. You can take not just leaderboards. It can be simple, like what I mentioned, right? You can have a small celebration in the classroom. You can have, distribution of certain sweets in the classroom. You can have all sort of encouraging and motivating small activities given to a child in the classroom. If you're looking at academia purpose in terms of subjects that you're looking at, there are a whole lot of things. You can, it depends which grade you're looking at. Firstly, if it's a lower grade or a midsection or a senior section. What is the interest of the child in terms of where is the trend of your class, or which normally comes through informal discussions or when children answer in the classroom? What is it that the students really enjoy? Where is the trend these days? It may be towards a certain trend in the market for a music which has been picked up, or it is a trend for a certain dance that the students have picked up, and use what fascinates a child. It can be Star Wars, which was a trend, or an Angry Birds that was a trend, and use that theme to keep the class engaged, and use the elements of game. It can be leaderboard, badges, or whatever that you feel will motivate a child. Use the combine that theme, which is maybe a trend. Obviously lower sections is very different to senior sections. Senior sections are engaged in a different kind of a trend these days. What picks their mind, you really don't know. So 9th, 10th is very different section. The mid section is different. So see the trend which is there, pick up that trend and infuse your, game design or game elements that you would want in the class, and have that motivating a child in the classroom to fail.
Thank you, madam, for answering the question. Again, the students, our participants seem to be having again a question which you have, I think, earlier answered about the templates or apps that can be used. So, which resources or platforms are available for?
It based on a survey which we did over more than a year. What is it that engages a child? Now, Star Wars was the trend, or children who are engaged in space rockets or ships. That is what something that we from the survey that we did with a lot of parents and children and the students and the teachers. So that was a theme that we picked up. If you have to use them, and we did this through a UI UX in-house developer and everything. So it's a lot of work that has gone in. But for teachers to do something like this, I will actually mail you a list of probably UI UX things that you can go and have your content ported onto it. But obviously, when you use these ready-made apps or uses, there's a limitation on customization that you could do. Okay, you can't really customize it to a great extent. There are apps available in the market. I will have this mail to Dr. Pallavi, who can share this with all the participants later.
Okay, madam, thank you. The next question is, how to teach science in EVS with the help of gamification? Again, I would like to link this with the another question which says, is it possible to correlate various subjects like English and math to a particular science or social science through gamification? And is there gamification for English in science?
Okay. A lot of topics, I think, is more, if I can understand what you mentioned is, they are looking for gamification for multiple subjects. I hope I am right.
English. One is multiple subjects and the other is, can you correlate these subjects with one another?
I mean, the second question is, how do you correlate?
I'll repeat that question again. First, you could take up the question on science, EVS, or science and English.
See, you can apply gamification in all your subjects. What we did, for instance, to give you an example, because you'll be able to relate, I just showed you the video, it is applied for maths, English, and obviously is for science also, as and when you move up. You can apply to history, you can apply to geography, you can apply to all your subjects, gamification. Gamification is not restricted to any one particular subject. You can apply to social sciences, you can apply to all your subjects. You can definitely apply to English. You can build your grammar. You can build comprehension skills. You can develop inference, reading skills. You can develop your word list. A lot of things can be applied in English. Obviously, it can be. It's there for maths, obviously, algebra, geometry, for senior students as well. For history, geography, yes, it can be done. It has to be done progressively. And see, the thing is, for all these topics, what you do, it has to be done progressively, level-wise, and stealthily, where things, children build it progressively. So all subjects, yes, it can be done. That answers the first question. Second question, I didn't really understand. Correlating the subjects, English into social sciences, is something which I didn't really understand.
What they meant is how you would bring about a correlation of science and maths. Science and maths, or say science and social science, science with history and geography.
But how do you really, not just gamification, how, if you're looking at overall score of a child, or how, if you're looking at overall, how is a child faring overall in all subjects? That's what if I figure out. See, you have something like, okay, how is he doing in maths? He's doing in social science. How is he doing in science? Probably other, additional languages that he may have taken up. He may do some well in one topic, he may not do so well in another topic. Okay, when he's not doing something well in another topic, right? You have a maths, for instance, algebra and geometry for a 9th standard student, okay? And you have history, geography. How do you really relate algebra to history, geography? You really don't relate. Right? You can't relate history and geography to algebra, geometry. These are different topics altogether. So I don't think you can correlate, but you can apply the same techniques of gamification either of the subjects and have the scores from all the subjects combined to see, that's what, if you paid attention to what I showed the last thing, you have the overall score of a child appearing. Okay, just as you have a marking system that you may have to show the parent that, okay, he stands here, and overall this is your score of a child. So you can have his math scores, you can have his social sciences and all other subjects that you may have, or elective subjects that the student has, to see where he stands overall. But topic wise, obviously, and within each topic, which of his topics, that how he is faring. So you can have detailed and granular analysis of a particular child. Yes, you can apply the same techniques for maths. You can apply the same techniques in social sciences. You can apply the same techniques in physics, chemistry, biology. Techniques are the same. The techniques are not different, but the topics are different, right?
Thank you, Madam. There is one more question which I would like you to address. Can we call Khan Academy an example of gamification? This question is by...
Yes, Khan Academy is an area of gamification. You definitely have a lot of players in the market, not just Khan. Khan Academy was one of the earlier, pioneers who started off in this field. Today, you have a lot of things. You have Mindspark, you have Dojo, you have a lot of, kind of companies who are specializing, their techniques are different. That's what I said. One size fits all is not the answer for this. You have a lot of, different techniques which are used. What appeals to the students, what engages the student is something, obviously you need to know the nerve of the child in your classroom, and the teacher knows the best, you know, how he or she, which class. So you may have 9th standard is a very different class, A standard, very different class, you know, what worked for 9th will not work for an 8th standard child. And in suppose 9th A works very differently from 9th B. So again, in the class, you have dynamics also. So you need to know the nerve, tap on the correct nerve of the student in your classroom, to understand and apply these techniques. And what works for 9th may not really work for 8th. That is one obviously thing that you need to keep in mind. And how do you really engage? Yes, there are a lot of players in the market. They do things differently. What really appeals to a child? So, yes, Khan Academy is one. You have a lot more other companies besides Khan Academy also doing this kind of thing.
Because please go ahead, ma'am.
Because today what has happened is online education has really picked up, in the not just COVID times, it has picked up a lot. But you see, only a certain section of society today is using online education, right? You have a lot of underprivileged students who don't have access to online education. So how do you use these techniques? You can use it only in offline education, right? So that's the reason I did touch on the last of offline education. You have, techniques which you can apply in classroom to engage such children as well. Online education is not, it's actually today still a privilege to most of the people. You have game and because the availability, the ease of internet. So obviously parents would like children to use their time productively rather than just sitting and playing YouTube and some video game. Have them, you do their study time unknowingly to keep a child productively engaged. That's one of the reasons gamification has picked up, because children are so immersed in playing games. So rather use these techniques and have their time more productively utilized, and it's more less strenuous for the parents. So gamification has picked up. It's become a huge area and has become a huge market today in education. Not only in education, it has been applied everywhere today. In fact, companies where I see, it has been picked up for recruitment assessment, is used for pre-screening of candidates, the same techniques today, and the same fundamentals which somebody raised this question, math, science, or EVS, or social sciences. So what companies today, we get a lot of requests, and we've been doing it for some of the companies, they don't want to spend time, going through and speaking through candidates, because there's so many resumes that are available. Just simply send them a test. You give this test, okay, that checks the fundamentals, say math, science fundamentals today, what you teach in school. We do this through a game. And if a person gets a certain score, then only let's go and interview the candidate. Why waste time even talking to a candidate if he doesn't have the basics in place? So it's used for pre-screening. Then you use these techniques today for recruitment assessment. What do you do in recruitment assessment? We give them. I'm just giving you an example to just give you a perspective. Just giving you a perspective outside education where things are applied. So you have, it just gives you an idea and, opens your mind up when you kind of have a recruitment assessment. What do they do for recruitment assessment? They give you a gameplay. Okay, this is going to be your day at work. So if you are applying for a role of, say for instance, sales manager kind of a role at a store. So this is going to be your day at work. A simulation is created, how it really works in a store for you as a salesman. And you kind of unknowingly, okay, a customer has come to you. How are you going to sell to him? So what I showed you, how Newton sleeps, is just a precursor to what real games can do in your day-to-day life. In this aspects. So I go for an interview. Okay, I don't meet any interviewer. I am told to log into a machine and with a certain credential, or I can do it from home also. I just log into that website, into this app, which I'm given by the employer to appear, and I get a case study. Now, case study is no longer limited to just, I have some text which is given and I have to give multiple choice answers. Today, those days are gone. So I go, just use a Mario example, right? Or an Angry Bird. So I represent myself as a store manager. I'll be seeing some like actual simulation of a store where I will be going to work. Similar thing I see today on as a game. And I will come, suddenly you'll see a customer coming to you and you certain questions. It can be in the form of a video or certain questions will pop up if I click over here and I answer those questions. Then there'll be, based on what I answer, the next step comes. You have to sell something. You have to go and sell some, probably a Kellogg's packet. And this is what do you do? So then you have simulation of that particular thing. So you have actual things which will, this is what I say, recruitment assessment happens today as a role play. So gone are those days where you actually sit with an employer, questions are come because everybody is so hard pressed for time. And obviously today, you know, face-to-face people are avoiding due to COVID, that is one. And how do you do things globally? If I am being interviewed by somebody in US, you have a time difference. I really can't connect with that person. I have a lot of other things. I'm screening almost 20 candidates a day. How am I going to sit interviewing 20 candidates besides doing my other work? So things have changed over a course of days. So gamification techniques are applied in a whole lot of way, you know. It can be simple thing. You unknowingly even you do it right now, right? You are given, to people want to sell toothpaste, right? They tell you, touch this card, win something, and they you keep collecting those scratch cards for the sake of winning extra toothpaste. Okay, so at the end, what is happening? Sales of toothpaste companies increasing, right? That you're spending money buying those scratch cards of that particular brand of toothpaste, and you know, PNG or ITC is increasing their sales of toothpaste over there, getting you to buy more toothpaste. But do you really need that many toothpaste, right? Your kids are vying for it today. Go and get me this, because when I buy the Kinder Joy, I get a toy inside Kinder Joy. So what are they doing? They're improving the sales of Kinder Joy, applying gamification techniques. These are things that unknowingly, stealthily, right? These are the same techniques. It's no different.
Thank you, ma'am. And there is one more question. Archana Shah has said that she is a chess coach. So can she use gamification for teaching the game of chess?
Yes. I mean, you can use applying. You know, it is a game, right? You're a chess coach, right? What more do you need? You're in a game. You can apply gamification technique. So, you know, you have two players in a chess game, right? Some child doesn't like his own, you know, he's on the receiving end. You can apply some of the techniques. It's demotivating for the person who's losing. So you don't have a scoring mechanism. You can have some other mechanism to motivate a child. So yes, definitely. In fact, games of chess, techniques of games of chess are being applied in other areas of life. So why not have it applied over here?
All right. And I was just wondering if we can take up one more question, Karuna ma'am.
Sure.
Yes, Manjeet, we can definitely go ahead with it.
Yeah, okay. I would just like to repeat, because when we were talking about correlation, the person who had posed this question has put it up once again. And we will. I would like Madam to look at this once again. And what Namrata Joshi says is that when we are correlating various subjects to a particular social science or a science concept as a part of the primary year program in an IB curriculum, we probe our learners to come up with the central theme for that particular unit. So what is the central theme, whether it is, you know, taking the science aspect or the social science or maths, what is the central theme of that unit? So how do we use gamification in such an instance? Madam, if you would like to throw light on this question of hers.
Sorry, I've just not been able to understand what is the question. Means social science is not wrong. Social science is history. And
can I ask Namrata to unmute herself and pose this question to you directly? Karuna madam, can we do that?
Yeah, I have been unmuted. Good afternoon.
Please
good
go
afternoon,
ahead.
Sanjot, ma'am. Yes, ma'am. Ma'am, so what we basically do is when we have been given a theme, like for example, how we organize ourselves. So under that, there are major concepts, like for example, government or you know systems or how certain things are organized look at a particular major thing, like how things are organized. So then, whenever we have a central idea related to maybe at a grade 3 level, we ask, we probe our learners in such a way that they can almost come up with that particular sentence that this is the central idea of this unit. For example, I'm not able to come up with that particular sentence, or for example, sharing the planet. So sharing the planet is about how is it that the organisms are related to a particular environment or a particular ecosystem? So here we don't want them to limit themselves only to science or SS. We also want them to come up with real life connections in English or something that they've seen for math. Okay, so in such a situation, or could be Marathi, could be some kind of an ICT experience that they've had. So in such a situation, when we want them to unravel the central idea, or to come up with something related to how the planet is being shared by all the living things. Can you just cite one example how we could do that? So we are basically trying to correlate it at least to 2-3 subjects, if not all. So how can we use correlation?
I think this is EVS, right? What you're talking about?
EVS, yeah. Basically, yes, it's EVS, right. But it's just that.
Yeah, see. I think for lower grades, the subjects kind of merge, right? You can't really have social sciences separate and your traditional sciences separate. So they can merge for them, if I get it right, correct? So, so it's more of a concept-driven thing for lower classes, because I see my daughter also, it's more of a concept kind of thing. Yes, you can definitely apply, because you can't really say, because for lower classes, you can't really have science as a subject. Lines are blurred over there. So yes, you can definitely, if you're trying to do, I'm not sure if you're doing a classroom session with them. Yes, you can definitely.
Classroom.
You will have a EBS as a subject, right? So you can, it's like what you mentioned, right? How do you share the planet, right? I mean,
yes, ma'am. Yes,
something
ma'am.
Related to ecosystem. So you can do it in Marathi, English, all subjects merge over there. So yes you can definitely apply now, because they are lower grades. It's demotivating for a child where the competitive spirit is not necessarily fully ingrained in them.
True.
You want children to participate. So obviously they are lower classes and you don't want a child to be left behind. So you don't, I wouldn't recommend really having a scoring system with them. Something like a badge kind of work with a child best in those grades, you know, or, you know, clapping works for them best, you know, and children participate. And you obviously want team spirit to be developed for them. So you can have a team develop more than an individual work over there. Grades go higher up, an individual thing works better for a child. So for lower grades, teamwork will work where each child gets to participate equally. So you can have one team versus another team. And obviously you can have a clap system working for them, a pat on the back, or you have a chart paper and get the teams to do a chart paper instead of you doing it. So obviously they are more creative. No, in terms of doing something like this, and it's very, very, it keeps them engaged also. Give them the same theme, how do we share our resources? You may have an eco-friendly kind of a thing and have them do this thing on a reusable paper kind of a thing. I have a, you know, chart paper mark team A versus team B. You could have put them paste over there, you know, toffees, or you could have something like flowers pasted over there for each other team versus the other team. Gather more flowers for yourself, you know, something which kind of relates to the theme of the topic, recycling things, which probably you may have, how to use your resources best, you know, this kind of a thing for them.
So,
and they are motivated enough, you know.
Ma'am, you are referring to a motivational chart, and the ones that you mentioned, you know, activities to build up team work. So basically those are class activities. So they, that we do. So those class activities will come under gamification?
Yes, that's what I said. It is, these are the same techniques that you can deploy, you know, in education itself. We are not going to do something new. It's unknowingly you are applying the same techniques, you know, in the classroom It need not just be scoring thing for the class, you know. It is, you just keep track of marks, you know, because we are so defined by the marking system of, you know, getting 90%, getting 80%, you know, and grade A, B, C in our report card, you know, it's very difficult to think out of it. So, you know, these are the same techniques that you can apply for your EVS thing itself. You know, obviously, not all schools have marking system for lower classes. Some schools normally start after grade 3 and grade 4 where they have a report card. So, you know, where things don't work on the scoring system for a child, you can deploy same techniques as gamification techniques. And these are same gamification techniques applied stealthily. This is what is a stealth mode. It is done in a stealth mode for a child.
Okay, ma'am. Great. Thanks a lot, ma'am. And thanks to all the HJC faculty. This was really very, very informative. Thank you, ma'am. I am unmuting myself.
Sorry, just to add on to what you said. See, all these techniques need to be interactive for a child. You know, it has to be addictive for a child. How will you get a child to learn something if it starts getting boring? It's because they have a very short span of attention. And with internet, it is becoming still difficult for them to sit in one place. For a child to sit with books for a longer time is becoming very difficult. Span of attention, focus is becoming very difficult for a child. So it has to be engaging. It has to get addictive for a child. So how do you do it? It is a challenge today for teachers, you know. I also see my daughter, you know, after some point in time, she loses focus. She needs to be engaged, you know, for a longer duration. So it has to be interactive and engaging for a child. Some children, you know, can sit hours, you know, that's why games, if you see, children don't blink their eyes when they're playing a game or watching TV. They just forget everything. The same technique you need to apply to keep the child very engaged in, with them, you know. This is the same technique you apply. Why do they love playing a game? You know, when you tell them you sit and play a game, they'll sit for hours together to play a game. So you need to ensure that you apply the same thing when you get them to do an activity in the class or get them to do their, you know, probably maths or, you know, their social sciences. What is it that they really enjoy? The same technique you have to deploy. It can be any technique, whatever is there, which can captivate the user and ensure that their progression develops gradually in a child. If you have the progression thrown very fast at the face of a child, he will lose interest.
Thank you so much, madam. Yeah.
I hope I was able to answer her question. At least get your concepts in the application. It's very important how you apply it to keep a child engaged.
I think, madam, we have addressed all the questions raised by our participants. Thank you so much for answering them so patiently. I now request my colleague, Dr. Vaishali Sawant, to propose the vote of thanks.
Good afternoon, once again, and thank you, Manjeet, madam. On behalf of our society, our principal, Dr. Anita Swami, madam, our staff, and all the participants, I express my heartfelt gratitude for making us understand the difference between game and gamification, Sanjot Madam, and convincing us that gaming and learning is a powerful vehicle for human learning. Thank you for indicating to us that gamification can be used not only to teach, but also to test students. Thank you for answering all the participants' questions satisfactorily. Thank you, madam. And it was a really truly interactive session, I would say. And all the queries, you know, we had a lot of queries. Of course, this is a new idea for us. We know about games in our regular face-to-face learning, but this is a new idea to us. And thank you for clearing all those doubts, queries that we had with respect to gamification in learning. A big thank you to Ms. Bhargavi AR, the co-director, Paratus Knowledge Ventures Private Limited, for all the help rendered to us in organizing this webinar. quoted by Mr. Robin Sharma, leadership is not about a title or a designation. It is about impact, influence, and inspiration. We, the HJCE team, is highly privileged to have a leader like our principal, Dr. Anita Swami Madam, who truly inspires and influences us to achieve greater heights. A big thank you to all the principals of various schools who deputed their teachers for this webinar. And I'm also thankful to all participants for being with us for this webinar and making the session truly interactive. It is said, individually we are a drop, together an ocean. My heartfelt gratitude to each and every wonderful member of the HJCE family for contributing their best once again for making this webinar a success. I now request the participants to please fill up the feedback form, the link which would be provided on the WhatsApp group as soon as this session gets over. Remember, filling the feedback form is a requisite for procuring your certificate. So participants, meet you online for more such engaging, insightful sessions in future. Have a good day. I now request our host and webinar coordinator, Dr. Pallavi Tadekar, to end the meeting.